morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who had said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah would suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all of the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead of them as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord is risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread."
Please pray with me. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be a living word which is derived from the written words. Amen. As we should strive to do every day, let us give thanks to God, our Creator, for Jesus, our Redeemer, and the many blessings in our lives. Even as we seek to be stirred by the Holy Spirit, who calls us far beyond our comfort zones. Amen? We give thanks for our lives and for our opportunity to worship together this day. This is the seventh and final Sunday of the Easter season. Next week we will celebrate the Christian season of Pentecost. We will change the liturgical colors to red. Some of us will remember to wear red. And as we remember the story which recalls the first day of the church, we will worship together in a new setting. On the final Sunday of the Easter season, as we think about the power of the resurrection, we remember our charge to be a part of God's resurrection in the world. That's what I told Maddie this morning. I said, as I kind of did to you, Aiden, the other day, we started the Easter season with your baptism, and we're concluding the Easter season with Maddie's baptism, and those are symbols for us all to understand and remember that each day of our lives, as we walk throughout this world which God placed us in, we are called to be the resurrection. In our baptism, we remember that in life, that in death, and life beyond death, we are not alone. And that God wants us to offer this world our authentic selves. I said to Maddie, as I say to you, God made you beautifully and wants you to know that you are loved by a God that never gives up on you. And once you claim that treasure and the value within, yours is the charge to share it with others. On this final Sunday of the Easter season, we remember our call to still roll stones away from the tombs of death by helping to share the love of God we know through the ways of Jesus. The resurrection is more than a proposition we believe. It's something we prove by the way we live it out. Amen? Next Saturday, we get to live it out, to share the joy we know, especially through music, as we have the Folk Song Fellowship with the One Shoestring Band. Now, if that's not a mouthful, why don't you come on up here and preach? Next Sunday, when you arrive to worship, you will notice that the sanctuary will have changed, and we will have one aisle. Now, I understand the last time when we went from one aisle to two aisles, it was a little shocking. So please don't be shocked as we move from two aisles back to one, as we continue to practice being nimble and trying things in different ways, or trying them the old way again. The table next week will be at the head of that one aisle on the floor, at least until Advent, to remind us all of our disciple identity, to remind us of our disciple history, and our mission in part to bring all disciples of Jesus around that table, the table that our Lord is host at as we gather as the church. It's in such a space that we find unity with Christ as the way. After our combined service next week, which is at 10:45, we will have a fellowship meal, which will include a ministry fair. May it be that you are inspired during worship. May it be that the Spirit stirs within you a passion to do a new thing, to find a ministry to be a part of, to find some way to turn towards yourself as we all engage in being the body of Christ in our communities. We'll have a ministry fair which will explain and offer ministry options for you to sign up and be a part of. We're also going to have an electronic help area for those of you who are like, I can't understand Simple Church, or I don't understand Simple Church, I can't make it work. We're going to have some crew of volunteers helping you get Simple Church on your phone in the correct manner. And for those of you who it drives you nuts not to have a picture of people in Simple Church, not mentioning any names like Brooke, we're going to have some people set up to take your picture so we can put them in Simple Church as we work on being church. We do it well here, folks, and often we do it with joy and we have fun, and it should be no other way. On the seventh Sunday of Easter, our scripture reading is the story called The Walk to Emmaus. It occurs right after the Easter narrative in the Gospel of Luke, and it takes place later in the day on Easter Sunday. This story is found only in Luke's Gospel. This text fit where we are as we move from a season of Easter, where we are still rolling stones, still looking for and participating in the resurrection of Jesus the Christ, to a season where we trust in the Holy Spirit and her breath of life, which beckons us to sweeter, wiser, more just living. But before we encounter those words in Acts, we look at Luke, who also wrote Acts. Luke's narratives takes us on the road frequently. A journey brings Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem, A road is the narrative setting for the parable of the Good Samaritan. A road leads the prodigal back home to his father. The road continues in the book of Acts, where, for instance, Paul encounters the risen Jesus on the road to Damascus. There is something about travel that evokes Luke's literary and theological imagination. There is something about roads, the way roads bring us together, the way roads can pose danger to us all, the way roads become a symbol of a faith on the move. The narrative of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus draws us to the conclusion of the third gospel. A number of Lucan themes are woven together in this narrative: table fellowship, hospitality, faithfulness, discipleship. Themes that make me think, at least this time around, that are similar to the core values of Southern Hills Christian Church, which we claim to be spirituality, koinonia, serving others, and worship. The scene on this road foretells the future of Christ's church in the Lucan imagery. I wonder what it says about the future of Southern Hills Christian Church. I wonder if this is a church on the move, sent out by a Jesus who walks alongside us even when we don't recognize him. So the two disciples are walking on the road to Emmaus. The events of the past few days have been tumultuous and confusing for them. A man whom they had believed was the long-awaited Messiah had been executed by the Romans. There were reports, though, by some women followers of the supposed Messiah, that his grave was empty. They claimed that he has risen from the dead. These were the topics under discussions for those two followers of the condemned man as they walked on the road to Emmaus. Through their conversations, they sought to find answers and to discover the truth so that they might be able to determine what to do in the days ahead. They are grieved by their recent experiences. They are talking to one another, hoping to make sense of the nonsensical, when Jesus himself walks alongside them and joins them on their journey. But in a sentence no English teacher would allow to stand, Luke recounts, "But their eyes were kept from recognizing him." English teachers don't tend to much like the passive form. This is very passive form. When Jesus asks the two disciples, what are they discussing? They are incredulous. Who doesn't know what has been happening in Jerusalem these days? It was all over the news. It was a trending topic on Twitter. Okay, maybe it wasn't a trending topic on Twitter, but it was big time news. Their dashed hopes are voiced in verse 21 when they say, "We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Had hoped. The disciples had hoped. It was past tense. Their hope was now gone. They had hoped Jesus was the Messiah who was going to usher in a new age. It is easy to identify with the two disciples. We've been in similar situations. Before the death of a loved one, we had hoped that healing and wholeness would occur. We had hoped to be offered a promotion, but it had been given to someone else. Because of what has happened in the past, we find ourselves both hoping and doubting. While we have wrestled with our hope and our doubts, I pray it is so that we have discovered that our doubting is not in opposition of faith. Doubting is not the opposite of faith, but rather doubting is a part of the life of faith. Our doubts can strengthen our faith, and they can direct our hopes to the one sure hope that we have in Jesus. Our hope is in Jesus because Jesus has conquered death. We hope in Jesus who has promised never to forsake us. When our hope is placed in Jesus, it never has to be past tense because Jesus will hope with us in the midst of our greatest struggles. The whole theology of Jesus' suffering provides for us an example of how to have faith in the midst of suffering. Our faith teaches us that when we suffer, especially because of Jesus, we do not suffer alone. We wish sometimes for the magic wand of faith. We hope sometimes for the Hollywood version of hope, where everything's going to be okay once the magical wand is waved. I reminded Aiden when he was baptized, faith is not a magical wand. Faith does help us find meaning and significance in our suffering. It reminds us that we are not alone. In response to the two on the road, Jesus outlines for them the meaning and the significance of his own death, starting from Moses and the prophets. Now also, there is an element of risk on this journey. We might miss it because we know the stranger is Jesus. But to the unnamed and the unknown travelers, he is still a stranger. It is night, and it is late. They offered hospitality. No, it is stronger than that. They urged him to stay with them. They insist on Jesus receiving their hospitality. The stranger and the guest then becomes Jesus, the host. As they approach their destination, the two disciples notice that Jesus seems to be planning on to keep walking. They plead with Jesus to stay with them. They offer hospitality to the one whom they believe is a stranger. They offer to be hosts to this traveling companion and to this new friend. And as soon as the table is set, Jesus upends the expected social roles. He becomes the host by blessing the bread and by sharing it. When Jesus does the most Jesus thing of all, everything changes. I wonder what we think is the most characteristic activity of Jesus. When we imagine Jesus, what is Jesus doing? For many, perhaps, Jesus may be preaching to a crowd. For many, maybe he may be healing the sick with the touch of his hand. For Luke, however, Jesus is most Jesus at an ordinary meal infused with significance because of the people gathered around the food. Jesus is there at this table, but also all the sinners and the tax collectors with whom Jesus shared meals are there. But not only that, also at the table are the many powerful people with whom Jesus also dined. One of the most characteristic activities of Jesus' ministry in Luke is eating. He is accused early in the gospel of being a glutton and a drunkard. Worse, he eats with all the wrong people. This is good news for us disciples. It's instructive that it's not Jesus' teachings that opens their eyes. It's not Jesus' presence that opens their eyes. It's his sharing of bread with his friends that opens their eyes. It's his blessing of food that opens their eyes. In this sharing of bread at an ordinary table, we catch a glimpse of Jesus' transformative kingdom. Now, Saturday night, from 6 to 8, we will have an opportunity to catch a glimpse of the kingdom as we practice one of our core values, hospitality. As part of that event, the free breakfast crew will be serving food. As we enjoy good music and fun fellowship, we will be purchasing food, which in turn, the money will then in turn support the free breakfast ministry. They will also be working at the fellowship meal after church next week as we receive an offering, a free love offering for the lunches that will be provided. And during the ministry fair, they will be raising money to help them with their ministry of hospitality and outreach that goes to the core of who we are as members of Southern Hills Christian Church. Supporting the free breakfast ministry supports people who are literally on the line, if not already, homeless. If you don't encounter or are not a part of the face of Christ with the free breakfast, I'm not sure where to suggest you look. You look. In Luke, eating is a radical act that breaks down cultural boundaries. In Luke, the resurrected Jesus shares that bread once again with his followers. And in feeding them, Jesus opens their eyes, helping them see that Jesus was with them the whole time. In the 9 o'clock service, we have a church member, Kate Boyce, who regularly worships with us. And she would be the first to tell you she is not a morning person at all. But she enjoys very much getting up on Saturday mornings very early to go to the free ministry breakfast and to simply sit at the table and enjoy a cup of coffee with her new friends and to experience seeking out and being the face of Christ in that experience. Although she would be the first to say, I never said I was the face of Christ, and please don't draw any attention to me. But this is the road to Emmaus. This story, the road to Emmaus story, reminds us that we must look for our own resurrection moments. We must be willing to move. We must be willing to have walking companions. We must keep our eyes open to holy wisdom from obvious and less obvious sources. And when our hearts burn, we must follow them. Friends, where is our road to Emmaus here at Southern Hills Christian Church? Is it the road of justice? Is it the road to forgiveness? Is it the road to marriage or the road to amicable separation? The road to dream chasing? The road of letting go? We are on our road and we have our companions. Are we willing to listen with them? Are we willing to see Jesus in them? Trust your heart to speak your deepest fears and desires as we ask ourselves if our eyes are open. Are we ready to meet Jesus in whatever form he takes? Are we brave enough to let our hearts be kindled with a new fire? May it be that we claim our identity as an Easter people and answer yes, yes, yes. May it be so. I think it's really important as people of faith, that especially in worship, that our words have meaning. In seminary, I was determined that all the religious words were empty, and then people use these religious words without thinking about their meaning. And I know I've shared this story, so I took on the task of rewriting all these religious words, and I wanted to give them all secular synonyms. Okay? Be able to say, talk about faith without using religious words. A good advisor helped me pare it down to one word. And so I focused on that one word throughout seminary, and it was hope. For me, hope is connection. A secular synonym to hope when we talk about it is connection. How are we connected to each other? It's just fun and fellowship on Wednesdays. How are we connected to each other? How do we provide hope to each other? Is it coming up with easy answers to hard questions? Or is it just being present with our sisters and with our brothers as they struggle, as they go through the darkest hours of their life? God knew, God knows that life would be hard. There would be so many things to distract us. There would be so many temptations to despair. God also wanted our lives of faith to have meaning, and was prayerful that we would reconnect with that meaning often. So we disciples claim this table as a part of our worship every week. Our worship experiences move towards this part. It is the climax. It is the focal point of worship. It is here that we connect with an identity bigger than any one of us. It is here that we join at the table with the sinners and the tax collectors. It is here at this table where we sup with the powerful people from the 18th, 19th, and 20th century, as well as the destitute, forgotten ones. We come to this table to connect with our identity as members of the body of Christ, to remember who we are. Because it was on the night that Jesus was to be betrayed that he took the bread and he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you." In similar form, after they had eaten, Jesus took up the wine and offered the blessing, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, offered for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us pray.
O God of resurrection and rebirth, thank you for sending Jesus for us to walk and hold beside. Thank you for the bread and the cup. Let it remind us to serve and share with each other. Let it connect us to each other and our larger community. In Jesus' name, amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. All is prepared and all are welcome. I've said it before, it's worth saying again. I invite you to stand to receive the commission. It's a song commission, and it is always a joy to be in worship with you. And this morning we'll be sent out, actually it's this afternoon, we'll be sent out to the song Still Rolling Stones as a commission to remember. It's our call to keep looking for that resurrection. So may you go from this place knowing you are loved by a God who never quits, never goes away, and never, ever gives up on you. Go in peace.
Stay dry. We did.
See you later.
Bye-bye. And I use your chest and brakes or I might have
next week.